Shall I begin now? Am I audible?
Nitin, you are audible. Your strength 5. You may please.
Okay. Right. Okay. Thank you, General Ahluwalia and Center for Land Warfare Studies for that introduction and the privilege to be the opening batsman in a very important seminar. And as the Chief of Army Staff, as well as you yourself have laid the groundwork, it has made my task both easy and tough because some of the points will be repeated since both of you made very important points about the multi-domain operations and the range of conflict, the spectrum of conflict going forward. Nevertheless, I'll attempt to try and highlight some of these challenges that are, I'm sure, to this audience are not new or not unknown. But the fact is, you've asked me to talk about two answers to the questions that you've posed, which I will do at the end of the presentation, which I am sure is about 12 to 14 minutes. Can we have the first slide, please?
Mr. Gokhale, sir, can you switch on your video, sir?
I will. I have switched on. Can you see me now?
Yes, sir. Now we can see you. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Right. So the point is, everyone now is aware and has talked about the changing nature of threats. But the fact is, some of the traditional threats are ever present. They're not going away. What has happened is there is an addition of threats in multiple domains, which are non-traditional and which are something, a new challenge that has been posed to the national security decision makers. Of course, they include cyber space, disinformation, propaganda, CBRN, as General Ahluwalia mentioned, and in my view, also internal migration. And I want to just take half a minute on that. India is in the midst of rapid urbanization. 50% of India's population by 2025 will be living in urban areas. And that could pose, if not a traditional security challenge, at least a non-traditional security challenge in terms of administration, governance, and also a cohesiveness in the society. Or at least there will be threats emerging out of that, which may not be kinetic in nature, but that will have tremendous strain on the cohesion in the society itself, is my personal view. And I think we need to pay a little more attention to the internal migration that is happening, not the reverse migration we witnessed last March after the pandemic and the lockdown was imposed, but the natural migration that is happening from India's rural areas and semi-rural areas to urban areas, and the effect on the cities and megapolis that we must take into consideration. India is also, Indian subcontinent, in fact, is prone to, I think, the highest incidence of natural disasters, calamities, pandemics, as we have seen now. Pandemics used to be talked about as a possible threat a decade ago, but now it is a reality, as we have seen over the last 1 year. Natural disasters, as we speak, there are some 180 people trapped in that tunnel in Uttarakhand. And if you look at every year, in the past decade, and not even going back further, we have had in the Indian subcontinent, not only in India, in the Indian subcontinent, major natural disasters, calamities, which have taken huge number of lives and have impacted economies of smaller countries and even smaller states or states in India. So that is the thing that even the military will have to be cognizant upon. And as we know, in South Asia, in Indian subcontinent, the militaries play a leading role as first responders to any of these calamities, be it natural or pandemics, as we have seen over the past 20-25 years or even more. So that's something that we must be aware of. This is a summation of some of the threats. Some of the normal kinetic threats or traditional threats are in the second slide, as you can see here now. We are part of a volatile neighborhood. Let's not forget three countries in this neighborhood, two big countries and one small country, can be called a nuisance if you want, our Western neighbor. Three nuclear armed nations in this region, and two of them have an adversarial relation with India. They have close nexus between themselves. They support each other. In fact, the bigger power, China, supports Pakistan in every domain possible: military, diplomatic, economic, and now even in terms of cooperation in the international domain. And both, as we know, since the 1940s or 1947 onwards, when partition took place, both have history of naked aggression against India for so many decades now. This cannot be wished away. In fact, they may not go into a full-fledged war against India, but they will continue to chip away at India in various domains, as we see. And one of the dilemmas that I have while speaking here right now is Raksha Mantri Rajnath Singh is making an important statement about the disengagement in Ladakh. And you can imagine my dilemma as a journalist. Whereas I want to be listening to that, I'm speaking here in clause. And therefore, I would say that China and Pakistan and their collusivity, that threat is not going to go away. It's going to only increase in different domains. The number of domains that we spoke about, the non-traditional areas and the non-traditional threats that are emerging from, not just from them, from others. We cannot also wish away the fact that we are part of, you can see the map behind me, it's the maritime map of the world. And India is bang in the middle of the Indian Ocean region, which is the new playground for the 20th century great game. If you know, can we have the points here, please? It's a new playground, as I keep saying, because the contestation between the United States as a non-resident power and China in South China Sea is a reality. India as a country has to be very careful in balancing the need to engage with China bilaterally, as well as being part of what General Ahluwalia mentioned, Quad, which I will mention. But apart from the problems of balancing, the fact is Indian Ocean region, by its very location, geographic location, is the center of gravity in the world today, because both ways, the traffic, mercantile traffic, commercial traffic, as well as the increasing forays by the Chinese PLA Navy in the Indian Ocean region, has brought in new threats in the region, because the primacy of the Indian Navy and of the United States is being challenged every day in the past 5 years, and it's only going to increase by the Chinese plan. And of course, the ever-present threats of drug and human trafficking, piracy, is going to be ever-present in this region and this domain, the Indian Ocean region. And we are going to increasingly see no war, no peace situations, as we have seen in Jammu and Kashmir for three decades now. And even with China, my personal belief is that the conflict or the skirmish and the pinpricks on the line of actual control, and unless it is settled, will continue to be a no war, no peace situation, except for this kind of small accidents or accidental killings that happen, like it happened in Galwan. So therefore, these are some of the things. Can we have the next slide, please? And why, therefore, as Director General Strategic Planning, or what used to be called Perspective Planning, mentioned, multi-domain ops are needed, because today's conflicts have no set beginning or the end, really. I mean, look at what happened in Iraq, or what is happening in Afghanistan. We cannot say the conflict started on such and such date and it ended on such and such date. We cannot celebrate victory days like we have done for the 1971 operation or for the Kargil conflict, because the nature of conflict has changed completely. And therefore, the militaries will have to really multitask. They will have to have readiness and preparedness for non-contact wars. Conventional wars will be rare. Tanks going in large numbers into another country, or trying to cut off another country into two pieces, will be a rare occurrence unless things really deteriorate. And therefore, I would think most tensions will be below the threshold of a full-scale war. So how do militaries prepare for it? Because today the domain doesn't remain like the old battlefields of deserts or mountains or even high seas. It's present in our drawing room, as I think somebody mentioned, or on the stock exchange. One cyber attack on India's banks or stock exchange or India's electricity grid can be also considered an act of war. How does the national security planner, how do national security planners prepare for that? And are the militaries going towards it? Is the question. These threats are now manifesting themselves very clearly, and in a real time frame, answers have to be found as a response to these threats. Now, so therefore, new skills and expertise are required for the militaries. They cannot be just content with doing what they've been doing for decades now, or maybe even a century, in terms of heavy equipment and platforms, large ships and big guns and large fixed-wing aircraft, combat aircraft. They have to be mobile, they have to be agile, they have to be tech-savvy and not just driven by valor. We respect and really pay our tributes to the valor of our soldiers. We've seen them, seen that time and again in Kargil, in before that in the 71 operations or 65 operations. But the nature of warfare, as this audience will not need any reminder, has changed completely. Therefore, a new age soldier, the millennial soldier, will have to be intellectually flexible. He'll have to have interdisciplinary skills and digitally empowered, because today anything can be done digitally, really, if you see. And therefore, ability to master the information warfare landscape, which I consider one of the key domains where India will have to step up. We are seeing that unrestricted warfare on social media platforms like Twitter, and the kind of resistance that big tech platforms like Twitter and Facebook are now sort of doing the pushback against Indian government's requirements of banning some of the handles or banning some of the Facebook pages. That is where the fifth domain, as I call it, we've had space, land, space, land and sea, apart from the subsurface. Now we will have to have expertise in information warfare landscape. That's where cyber warriors will have to be created. And that's where multi-domain expertise is needed from the new age soldier, as I mentioned. That's where I think the future planning will have to be concentrated. And the Indian Army will have to get there, as the General Naravane mentioned about the drone swarms, and the demonstration of drone swarms on Army Day was one example of how the Indian Army is already thinking ahead. But talking about the two major threats or major challenges, about what are the two major challenges here in the Indian subcontinent. One, of course, as I mentioned, the collusive threat of China and Pakistan is not going away. They may not go or launch a kinetic war or a major war, but they will continue to unleash a proxy war in JNK and in other areas. In the information domain, as we know, the Chinese used to dominate the apps market in India, which India has thankfully taken steps to ban them, as many of them as possible. But the cyber security and the cyber operations domain, the Chinese have a lot of head start, where India will have to be very careful in handling that threat from China, especially. And China can use Pakistan as a proxy. So that is the big threat. And how does Quad, just to answer and making the last point here, the Quad, I would think, will take some time in becoming operational in the military domain. I think initially it will be quite cooperative. The Quad countries will be cooperating on economic, diplomatic and political level, while each country in the Quad grouping has its own problems and relations with China. So all of them will choose carefully how they come up with the military solution or a military response to China. As India keeps reminding all the other three members of the Quad, it's only India that has land borders which are contested with China. All the other three do not have such a problem. So India will have to make its own choice in dealing with Quad on one hand and China on the other, like Australia will have to do because of its commercial interest and the kind of deep roots that the Chinese have in Australia, and so will have the Americans have to do that. Japan, I'm not sure how it is going to deal with it, but India, Australia and US, all of them have their own dilemmas in making Quad stronger militarily while balancing their needs to be bilaterally engaged with China, and dependence on China on many cases in terms of trade and some of the other issues that dominate the non-military domains. So that's where I think I will stop. And once again, let me thank General Ahluwalia and Claus for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to listen in to other erudite experts. I'm privileged and honored that you asked me to speak right at the beginning. I don't know whether I made the essential points, but again, thank you very much for this honor.
Nitin, thank you very much for a very insightful and informative talk. And you have covered a very wide canvas in exactly 15 minutes. My compliments to you. I'm sure you're going to hold on with us because we'll have interactive session. We'll have you have actually covered traditional and non-traditional threats in a very comprehensive manner. As also you've spoken about the Indian Ocean region as the new playground, undoubtedly, as also about the gray zone environmental concept, and we require new skills and expertise to deal with multi-domain operation. Thank you so very much. Now the next speaker that we have, our second speaker, is Air Marshal Stuart Evans from the United Kingdom. He was a senior military